This video is part three of a series about how to set up your own live stream capable video podcast studio. In my last video, I talked about all the gear that you would need and the setup required, but in this video, we're gonna dive into the software. So without further ado, let's get into it. Now, before we get into it, there are three things I need to mention. Number one, I will be using a PC for this video, but all the software we're going to talk about will be available on PC or Mac. Number two, links to all the software discussed in this video will be in the description down below. And number three, you may notice as I go through the software that I'm skipping through some settings, and that's because we're just going to be focusing on the settings that you need to get up and running. Now, the bulk of this video will be dedicated to setting up OBS, aka Open Broadcaster Software, but depending on the gear that you ended up getting for your podcast studio, there may be some other software that you will need. So we're going to go through those quickly before we get into OBS. First off, let's talk about capture cards. Now, if you ended up getting the Camlink 4K capture card, like I mentioned in my last video, you won't actually need any software for that. You can just plug it into your computer and all the drivers that you will need will be installed automatically. But if you ended up getting the Blackmagic ADA Mini switcher board like I have, there is some software that you'll need to download. The software, which can be downloaded from the Blackmagic website, will come with ADAM setup and ADAM software control. And you can open each of those independently, or you can access ADAM software control by clicking this little icon within ADAM setup. Now, for our purposes, there's nothing we need to change in ADAM setup, but there is a setting we need to tweak in ADAM software control. So once you have ADAM software control open, just click the gear icon in the bottom left corner of the screen, and this is where you're going to set your resolution and frame rate. Now, the max resolution that the ADAM Mini offers is currently 1080p, so I would recommend setting your resolution to that, unless, of course, you are exporting a lower resolution like 720p from your camera. In my case, I'm actually exporting a 4K signal from my Sony a6500 and then downscaling it to 1080 in the ADAM Mini, and that's just to get a little bit of extra sharpness. So in my case, I'm gonna go ahead and also select 1080p. And then for frame rate, you just wanna make sure that it matches whatever frame rate you're exporting from your camera. If, for example, you're exporting 30 frames per second from your camera and you set your ADAM Mini to 24 frames per second, you could experience what looks kinda like a stutter in your video, and you don't want that. So just make sure that the frame rates match on both. Moving on to audio interfaces, you typically won't have to download any software for most audio interfaces. Typically, the drivers will be installed automatically when you plug them into your computer. But if you happen to have the Rodecaster Pro like I do here, you will want to download some software from the Rode website. The app you will want to download is called Rodecaster Pro, and basically it just allows you to update firmware as well as customize your soundboard. And finally, if you happen to have the Elgato Stream Deck, you'll want to download the Stream Deck software, which will allow you to customize all the buttons. All right, and with those out of the way, let's go ahead and jump into OBS. Now, when you first open OBS, you may see a screen that looks like this. On the left side is a preview, and on the right side is what you're actually recording or streaming. This is known as studio mode, but in my case, I turn it off because sometimes I get confused about which is which. So I'm just gonna click this studio mode button here, and now I'll just have the one screen, and this is gonna show me what I'm recording and streaming. So let's dive into some of the settings here. I'm gonna click settings on the bottom right of the screen. Let's make this a little bit bigger here. And let's start by clicking the video tab on the left side there. And you'll notice that these are grayed out, and that's because I'm actually using OBS to record this right now, but they won't be grayed out for you. So you'll be able to change these settings. Up at the top here, you'll see base resolution. Now this is the resolution that's coming into your computer. Now in my case, I mentioned that I'm exporting a 4K signal from the Sony a6500, but it's getting downscaled to 1080p in the ADAM Mini before it ever gets to the computer. So in this case, my base resolution is gonna be 1920 by 1080. And because we intend to be recording and streaming at the same resolution, our output resolution is also going to be 1920 by 1080. For downscale filter, go ahead and select bilinear and then select your frame rate. And again, your frame rate should match whatever's coming into the computer. In my case, I'm using 24 frames per second, so I've selected 24 NTSC. Next up, let's go into the audio tab here. And up at the top, you just want to make sure that a sample rate of 48 kilohertz is selected and stereo channels is selected. Below that is devices, and this is where you'll select your default audio devices. In my case, I use the Rodecaster Pro for inbound and outbound audio, so I have those selected here. The rest of these default settings should be fine, so we're going to go ahead and move on to the stream tab. Now, this is where you're going to enter server and stream key data for whatever streaming service you happen to be using. In my case, I use YouTube, so I have my YouTube server URL URL here and my stream key entered below that. You can select a service preset from the dropdown up at the top here if you want to, but for me, it's just easier to enter the details manually. Next up, let's move on to the output tab, and we're gonna start here on this streaming tab. Before we do anything, you wanna make sure that your output mode is set to advanced. Now, it's a little difficult to see here, but you wanna make sure that you select audio track number one, and we'll get into why we do that here in just a minute. Below that, you'll see encoder, and you wanna be sure to select X264, and that's going to force your computer's CPU to handle everything that has to do with streaming. Make sure enforce streaming service encoder settings is checked, and then for rescale output, go ahead and leave that unchecked. We already set what our output resolution is gonna be on that video tab, so there's no need to change that setting here. Next, we have rate control. Go ahead and select CBR there. CBR stands for constant bit rate. Below that is bit rate. Now, YouTube actually recommends a max bit rate of 6,000 kilobits per second for 1080p footage, and since that's all we're outputting and that's all that YouTube is gonna be allowing, then there's no use using any extra bandwidth in increasing that, so we're just gonna go ahead and set that to 6,000 kilobits per second. Below that, you wanna set your keyframe interval to 2. I'm gonna be honest here, keyframe intervals is one of those concepts that I haven't really fully grasped yet, but from everything that I've seen and all the research that I've done, it seems like everyone says, yes, set your keyframe interval to 2. Finally, you wanna set your CPU usage preset to very fast, and this is one of those things that you can toggle a little bit if you start to experience any lag or issues with your streaming. Next up, we're gonna go to the recording tab here. You wanna be sure, once again, to set your output mode to advanced and set type to standard. Recording path refers to where your OBS recordings are going to be saved. I would recommend saving them directly to your Mac or PC or to a high-speed external SSD drive. Regular hard drives may not have the right speeds to be able to keep up with the recording, so it's always good to save to a fast drive. For recording format, you wanna go ahead and select MP4. You may see this warning pop up when you select that, but I would go ahead and disregard it. I've been using this recording format for a while and have never experienced any issues. Then down here for audio track on the recording tab, we wanna make sure that we select audio track number 2. And again, we'll get into why we do this here in just a minute. For encoder, I have NVIDIA NVENC H264 selected, and this is going to force my GPU to handle everything that has to do with recording. Now, if you remember on the streaming tab, we set our encoder to X264, which means our CPU is gonna be handling everything that has to do with streaming. But on the recording tab, we're gonna set the encoder to our GPU so that our GPU is handling everything that has to do with recording. And this is gonna allow us to distribute the load per se. So streaming is gonna be handled by the CPU and recording is gonna be handled by the GPU versus say the CPU handling everything or the GPU handling everything. Now, depending on which GPU you have in your system, you may not have this NVIDIA NVENC H264 parentheses new parentheses option, but you should see your GPU from that dropdown, whichever it happens to be. Below that is rescale output. We're gonna leave that unchecked because again, we already set that up in the video tab and we're not changing the output resolution. Down here, we have rate control. Now, contrary to the streaming tab, we're gonna set our rate control to VBR, which stands for variable bit rate. Now, my understanding is that when you're recording, it's better to use a variable bit rate if you don't have a lot going on in the scene or you're not doing a lot of scene switching. If you typically only use one primary camera angle, there's not gonna be a whole lot changing within the frame, so you can afford to use a lower bit rate in some cases. Once you select VBR, you're going to want to set a bit rate range. Now, I've selected a bit rate range of 40,000 to 60,000 kilobits per second, and this is based on the fact that, for example, the Sony A6500 outputs 1080p 24 frames per second footage at 50,000 kilobits per second, so that's gonna be about right in the middle of that range there. And setting a high bit rate for your recording is going to ensure that your recording is high quality, so if you wanted to take it and maybe, you know, cut some clips out of it later on, you can do that. Below that is keyframe interval. I have that set to 2, and then for my preset, I have max quality selected and my profile set to high, and depending on the speed of your system, you may be able to toggle those a little bit to get a little bit better performance. Go ahead and leave look ahead unchecked. You want to check psychovisual tuning, GPU, set that to 0, max B frames, set that to 2. Next up, let's go to the audio tab, and once again, set that output mode to advanced up at the top. Now, if you remember on the streaming tab here, I had you select audio track 1. On the recording tab, I had you select audio track 2, and now I'm going to explain why we did that. Using YouTube as an example again, YouTube only allows you to stream a max audio bit rate of 128 kilobits per second. However, if you're also recording your live streams, you're going to want to save a high quality version of your audio. So what we can do here is assign different bit rates depending on what we're doing. So since track 1 is what we selected for streaming, we're gonna go ahead and select 128 from the drop down there, and that's going to ensure that we're only streaming a max bit rate of 128 kilobits per second, because we don't need any more bitrate because you're going to be capped at 128 kilobits per second. On the contrary, we're going to select 320 from the dropdown for track 2 because that is our recording track and we want to make sure that we're recording high quality audio. So that's all we need to talk about within settings for now. Let's move on and talk about scenes and sources. So down here on the bottom left of the screen is where you will see your scenes and sources. Scenes are a collection of sources, and sources are, say, your camera angles and other media. So for example, you might create a new scene called podcast, and then within that scene, you might add your camera angles, a screen capture, maybe some media like a video or some images. And as I turn some of these on and off, you can see how they change. So let's start by creating a new scene. So I'll just click this little plus button down here in the scene window, and let's just call it podcast. Hit okay. So now we have an empty sources window here. So let's add our first camera angle. We'll click the plus button here and add a video capture device, which is what we will use to add our camera angle. So click on that and give it a name, say camera one. Hit OK. And from the device dropdown, that's where you will most likely select your capture card device. In my case, it's the Blackmagic Design, which is the Ada Mini here. And you'll notice that when I select that, nothing shows up behind it here. And that's because that source is already being used in this main camera and intro scene. Now, I will say adding a video capture source if you're using the Ada Mini switcher board is actually really simple. And usually all the default settings will work just fine.
And adding a source from the Camlink 4K or any other capture card is also super simple. It just takes a couple clicks.
And now just for fun, let's add a display capture. So I'll click the plus button under sources and I'll go to display capture. I'm gonna call this one 4K monitor. Hit okay. And then I will be given a drop down here. I have two options because I have two monitors. I obviously wanna be using the 4K monitor. So I'm gonna choose display number one. Hit OK. Now what you're seeing right now is kind of an infinite mirror effect going on because it's displaying the same monitor that I'm currently using. But one thing you'll notice is that it looks really zoomed in. And again, that's because it's recording my monitor, which is a 4K resolution. However, our base resolution was set to 1920 by 1080. So to fix that, all we need to do is go up into the top corner here and just kind of resize it a little bit. There we go. And let's say we don't want it to fill the entire frame. We can always size it down a little bit and maybe just put it in the corner or move it wherever we so please. And there are a whole bunch of other options to choose from. You can add a media source, which would be like an image or a video. You can add a browser source. You can do an audio input capture. There's a whole bunch of options depending on what you're trying to accomplish. Over here, you will see the audio mixer, and this is where you will see the devices that you selected on the audio tab here. Now, one issue that you could run into if you're using an audio interface is audio latency, meaning that the video and the audio don't exactly sync up. Luckily, OBS has a feature that allows you to correct that. So all you need to do is right click in the audio mixer section here, go to advanced audio properties, and under this sync offset section, that's where you can adjust that. And in order to do that, it may require a little bit of testing. You may have to change the sync offset a little bit, do a test recording, see how it sounds, and then go back and tweak it again. I find that when you do these tests, it's best to do things like clap your hands and snap your fingers, because that just kind of gives you a more visual representation of how close your audio and video are synced up. Another thing to mention here is audio monitoring. If you are using an interface to monitor your inbound and outbound audio, which I suggest that you do, you want to make sure that you turn monitor off for all audio devices. And the reason for that is, let's say you turn monitor and output on, what that has a tendency to do is double up your audio, so you're gonna get like a weird echo. So just keep monitoring off and rely on your audio interface to monitor your audio. And finally, for tracks, you wanna make sure that at least tracks 1 and 2 are selected for all of your audio device, and those tracks correspond with our streaming and recording tracks. So let's go ahead and close that out, and I wanna go back into settings one more time and talk about hotkeys. Hotkeys will allow you to assign keys on your keyboard, which you can use to control various commands within OBS. Let's say you want to create a hotkey to quickly cut to your display capture. I can go down here and where it says show 4K display, which corresponds, by the way, with this source down here. Next to show 4K, let's say I want it to be the 0 on the number pad here. Type that there. And then let's say to hide it, I want it to be number 1 on the numpad, so I'll click in there, hit 1. Now if I apply this, hit OK, watch what happens when I hit the 0 key. Now it's gonna show my desktop, and then if I hit the number 1, it's going to go back to my main camera angle. And let's say you want to change that hotkey later, just go back into your settings, go to hotkeys, find that hotkey and click the little delete button next to it. Now you may notice that I don't actually have any hotkeys set up, and that's because I switch between my different camera angles with the Ada Mini or with the Elgato Stream Deck. And the last thing we're going to talk about when it comes to OBS are these little numbers down here at the bottom. Now this is basically going to tell you how long you've been streaming for, how long you've been recording for, your CPU usage, and your current frame rate. Now as you can see, my CPU usage is nice and low, right around 2% or so on average. And if you see any spikes here, that's an indication that you're overloading your CPU and you may want to pull back a little bit on some of your settings. To get an even more detailed view of your stats, you can click View and Stats up the top there. And this window will give you even more data to work with. So we're going to see CPU usage again at the top. It's going to show you how much disk space you have available, how much memory you're using at the moment. It'll show you your current bitrate usage. It'll also show you dropped frames. And if you have dropped frames, that's another indication that you may be overloading your system and need to tweak your settings a little bit. Hey, before we go on, I just want to mention something that I realized I forgot to talk about in the original video, which is how to actually go about starting a recording or a live stream from OBS. And it's super simple to do. Starting with recording, all you'd have to do is go to the bottom right hand corner and press the button that says start recording. That will initiate the recording within OBS and it will be saved to the folder location that you set within settings. And then to start a live stream, all you have to do is click the start streaming button. And what that'll do is it'll force OBS to generate a feed which will then be sent to whichever streaming service you will be streaming to. And then as long as your stream server and key data are correct within OBS, you'll be able to see your feed coming through within whatever platform you're using to do your live stream. When you're done with either, just hit stop streaming or stop recording and that will end those processes. And that's pretty much it. Ryan, back to you. Now there's a lot more to OBS than we've gone through in this video here, and depending on your unique setup, there may be some additional settings and options that you'll need to tweak and change. But generally speaking, and if you follow the guidelines in my gear video, you should be up and running at this point. That said, if I missed anything or if you just need any clarification on anything I talked about in this video, leave me a comment below and I'll do my best to help you out. If you got any value out of this video, I would greatly appreciate it if you hit the subscribe button, hit the like button, and be sure to go subscribe to the Hafey Digital Podcast as well. It's a once weekly podcast where I talk about all things related to cameras, editing, photography, creativity, etc. I also live stream the podcast every Sunday on the Hafey Digital Podcast YouTube channel, so be sure to check that out as well. And with that, I think I'm going to call this video done. Thanks so much for watching, and we'll see you in the next one. Bye-bye.